Ia ta whakatere I te waka, kei pari pari ai e te tai. Ka mone neu I te kura, ka whakamaroti atu. Ka whakaoki mai ki, te kapua whakapipi. Ko te mea tuatahi, ka mihi atu au ki a koutou o Ngāti Whātua, ngā mātā waka, ko hui hui mai nei I tēnei pōki te whakarongo ki tēnei ui kōrero, e tēnei rangatira, tēnei maraikura, nō reira, ngā mihi ki a koutou, e rai rangatira mā koutou I haere mai, tēnā koutou, nau mai, haere mai. Ko te... no te waka o te aroa hau, no Ngāti Tūwharetoa, Tūhourangi, Ngāti Whāio, Ngāti Pikiao hoki a hau. Nō reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa.
Kia ora.
Ai, ka nui ngā mihi atu ki a tātou katoa, ka nui ngā mihi. Kia koe e kōnau I hapuare tēnei hui, a ngā mihi atu ki a koutou. Ka huri ngā whakaaro ki a rātou e takoto mai ana I ngā marae maha putano I te matu I tēnei wā. Ka anō reire I ngā tēnei matea, takoto mai rā haere, haere, oki oki atu. Hoki mai ki a tātou tēnei rā, ngā mihi atu ki a kaurua I mihi mai, ngā mihi atu ki a koe e hoa. Pai te rongo I tō reo, pai te ki te a koe anō. Ko tēnei he uri no te taitokirau, no karikari I taku kāinga tūturu I te rohe o Ngāti Kahu. Ko te rarua hoki, ko Ngāti Whātua ki te wairo hoki. A hau e noho nei kunei. No reira ka tukuna atu ngā mihi, ki a koutou katoa ko a hara mai. I tēnei rā, kia ora mai anō tātou.
Kia ora mā. Thank you. Now it was quite funny because this lady came up to me, she said, What's this event? I said, I think it's a women's gathering, something. She goes, is this not the Flying Nun event? No, well, you know, yours will be quite ragey too. Anyway, it's my delight to be here. Now, I feel like I'm ripping you off because, you know, I just like, my job is to sit down and gas bag to people. I just love it. I can't believe they pay me for that. And then to sit down and gas bag to people that I really like is something really special because sometimes it's not that case, you know. And so this invitation came and it feels like yesterday that I was speaking with Margaret at Waitangi. So the conversations continue because, you know, the camera goes off and you're like, oh, you know, and then, you know, text. So that's how it rolls. You know, we talk about this sort of stuff. It's funny how people say, let's have a national conversation because it's like, how have we been doing that all the time? That's all we talk about. We don't talk about fashion and rugby and boyfriends or whatever. We're like, the treaty, honestly, this is us. So thank you for joining us tonight, and it is a real honour to sit down and speak with Margaret Mutu. She's like, I think of her as part of the Brains Trust. Like there's brainy people in your lives, you know, she's one of them, she's really clever, and she's very articulate. As she mentioned in her whakatauki, her PPR, she comes from up north, and she's got a very impressive CV. I mean, we know her as a commentator, as an academic, as a writer, as someone who has gravitas on many subjects. She's also locked into her community, her iwi. She's the chair of the marae, of two marais. I mean, that must have its own challenges. Yeah, see? Okay, and because we're not that kind of show, we're going to zip it about them. And of course, on Te Runanga, right? And on the iwi chairs forum, right? So that's when all the iwi chairs, all the different iwi, how many would there be, Margaret?
73.
Oh, wow. Imagine that, eh? All getting together. Wow. And then Margaret, who, are you still the chair of the chair?
No, no, there's no chair of the chairs.
Oh, okay.
You have to fight hard to stop there.
I love it. And of course, as a professor, and up at the university, I think she gave one lecture to my son. I think he passed. But he's got all these. He's
traveled. He was good.
Oh, thank you. He's a good boy. And of course, has done residencies as a visiting professor overseas, as well in places like France and Hawaii and in the States. She comes with an amazing, I was going to say revenue, but that's not the word, resume. Resume. I hope there's revenue in there somewhere. And when I say she's part of the Brains Trust, so one of the things that my partner and I did, we wanted New Zealanders to understand what treaty settlements were about. And so I created a Brains Trust who would help guide us. So Margaret was on there, Moana Jackson, and David Williams. And they helped us select and identify different tribes whose stories could be told in this very predetermined, fractious environment that's been set up to so-called settle treaty grievances. Anyway, we'll get into that later on. But apart from that, this is a big long-winded start, but hey, I've got the time. She's like really flash with maths. She is. She's like, she got a degree in pure and applied math. Who knows what that is? That's so flash.
It's cool.
She's a beacon of hope. She is indeed. Now, and feeling hopeful, which is one of the surprising things that I took away from her up at Waitangi, when most of us were ready to like, oh my God. Anyway, as a mathematician, with a degree in pure and applied maths, how would you rate the chances of there being a referendum on the treaty?
Not zero, as much as I'd like it to be zero.
Mm.
I think that there is a chance that it could go through. The reason I say that is that I watch David Seymour and watch how very, very determined he is to get his way, and he doesn't care how he gets his way. And he will just drive it through. I don't know that the national people you've got there are experienced enough to be able to stop him if he is very, very determined to get it through. The other thing is that's quite sad is that if a referendum was put, most of this country knows nothing about the treaty. And so the referendum would probably be the same as Australia. It would be won. However, I have to say that I hope that we've got our act together well enough by then so that it won't impact us anyway.
We've got to get our act together. Well, in terms of accuracy, what mathematical percentage of the proposed Treaty Principles Bill reflects the text of Te Tiriti, the historical context and reo?
There's a tiny bit in there. But it's probably less than 10%. So what's actually in there is some selected phrases out of Te Tiriti, mistranslated, horribly mistranslated, to imply that Māori don't exist in this country. So it's another area that I love is linguistics. And mathematics and linguistics, you know, there's a tie-up. Yeah, patterns.
Yeah. Patterns, you see patterns.
So, in terms of the bill that got leaked by people in the Ministry of Justice who were just absolutely gobsmacked at what was being done, and there are some really good people in the public service who can see when things are really wrong, found their way to be able to leak that paper to the media, who immediately sent it to me. I said, can you please comment? Yes, it's so, as I said, it cherry picks certain words and then redefines them. So the classic one is rangatiratanga, of course. And rangatiratanga, as Moana got me to explain when she was talking to me at Waitangi, rangatiratanga is something really quite special. It's about our, it comes from the word rangatira. And our rangatira, our kaumātua at home were really, really clear about what rangatiratanga is about, and about what rangatira, what the job of a rangatira is. So all these wannabes who want to be rangatira, you've got to be there for the people. And it's the people who appoint a rangatira, because a rangatira's job is to keep the people together. And it comes from, as I explained with Moana, that ranga and tira, where a ranga is a shoal of fish, but raranga is also to weave. And you know how a shoal of fish always swims together? They can peel off now and then, but they'll come back together. And a tira is a group of people. And so the question that's asked is, when the group of people is wandering around aimlessly, who can bring them together? And it is the person who can weave them, and that's the rangatira. So a rangatira's job is not to dictate to people what goes on. A rangatira's job is to sit and listen to the people and make sure you've understood everything from every point of view you can possibly get. That's why our hui is always open. You know, these things
long,
about...
Long.
Yeah, and the... When I hear politicians saying, oh, I didn't get an invitation. Excuse me, you don't need an invitation to a hui. If the matter relates to you, you go to the hui so that you can have your say. So the rangatira listens to that and then at the end of it guides the people to make a decision on it. It's not the rangatira's decision, it has to be the people's decision. Now, rangatira tanga is the exercise of that ability to bring the people together so that they can, well, it's as simple as be healthy, wealthy, prosperous, and live together as you should always have been able to live together. But rangatiratanga is about the people, and it's about keeping the people together and making sure the people survive, succeed, and achieve what it is they want to achieve. Everything that David Seymour wants is around the English cultural notion of the right of the individual. Now, that's a very strong English notion. Nothing wrong with it, it's just different. But rangatiratanga does not meld at all with individual rights, because the smallest unit you have over which a rangatira will have a say is the whānau. It's not the individual. One, I find it really odd when people talk about people's individual mana and individual. There is
individual,
no such thing.
He was talking about at Waitangi, tino rangatira tanga for all.
Doesn't work.
Yes. So one of the, I'll just ask, how many of you here feel confident about having a debate about te tiriti? Put your hands up if you feel comfortable.
Who
what?
Me and Margaret. Okay, we're at about three or four. Okay, now that's no reflection on, as was mentioned in my show on Monday, so, you know, the history and te tiriti was only introduced last year. Mind you, we all do have eyes and ears and we could actually do a bit of research, but we'll put that aside. So there's a lot of stuff that's floating around out there that it's easy to think, oh, okay, yeah, that makes sense. And so one of the questions that I've been asking people is to cut through the myth. Now, how do we equip ourselves for this conversation? Well, the first thing is we need to understand what happened. What was the historical context? Because some of the people that are talking about the treaty, they're just looking at specific words, not all the words, and kind of forgetting that there was a lot going on way back there in 1840. So can you give us a little potted a potted light. Okay, here you go. Here's the situation that the treaty came out of.
Ka pai. All right. So we've been toing and froing across the Pacific for hundreds and hundreds of years. It doesn't really bother us that we don't know exactly how many centuries it was, but it was certainly many, many generations that we were toing and froing before we came and settled here. You know, whether it was 1,000, 2,000 years, I don't know, but it was long, long before any Pākehā ever came down here. And by the time Pākehā arrived here, pretty well settled around the country, still having a go at each other and still, yeah, not being all that friendly if you stood on my toe and I didn't revenge it. But we got on with things. Pākehās came in, and really up until the 1830s, there would have been no more than a couple of hundred of them here. Some of them were okay, seemed to be okay. In particular, although initially the missionaries weren't liked, they did eventually manage to make themselves okay with our people, to the point that when I was doing research on the Muri Whenua land claims, and I wanted to have a go at the missionaries who ended up with a whole heap of our land, my kui has told me no. She said they were respected people, they were good people. The people who weren't were their children, because they hadn't learnt the things that they hadn't taken on the same responsibilities, so they wouldn't give our land back when they were supposed to. So the missionaries were there, but what was starting to happen in the 1820s, 1830s, was that some of them were a pretty rough and ready lot. And some of them congregated around Kororarika, which is Russell, and they just ran amok. There was complete debauchery. There's a book called The Hellhole of the Pacific, and it was the hellhole of the Pacific. It was known internationally as the hellhole of the Pacific. And that was Pākehās there with absolutely no laws at all running amok. Now, these people were of concern to our rangatira because this is a Māori country. You've got Māori law here. It's called tikanga. And these people just would not abide by it at all. So the missionaries advised them to... Because the question was, if you people can't, you know, control them, who can? And so they told them to go and visit the King of England. And they did. And they saw over there that the King of England did in fact know how to control those Pākehās, slapped them in jail. So they came back here saying that yes, there was a way of controlling these people. But first of all, you had to let them all know what it was that the law of this country was, who was in charge of the country, and who made the laws, and who was the ultimate power and authority. Now that was set out in 1835 in the document called He Hakaputanga o Te Rangatiratanga o New Tenenia. It was a declaration of independence or a declaration of sovereignty. And it said exactly that this is where the power and authority sits in this country, is in the rangatira, with the rangatira of the hapū.
And Markita, can I just confirm that was drafted or signed or affirmed by a Crown representative at the time, Busby?
He drafted it because he said that you needed effectively a constitutional document to state where power and authority lay and where how the laws were to be made. He drafted it, but then it was translated into the reo. Now, he didn't sign it. It's not for him to sign it. It was only ever signed by the rangatira. So it was only the Māori document that was signed as well. But the English translation, and I'm a linguist, I don't like the translation. It's not a good translation. But it's closer than the treaty one was. Okay. That got sent to the King of England. The King of England was fine. This was a sovereign nation. he recognised the sovereign nation. He even had to have a flag so that their boats didn't get arrested when they went to Australia.
Do you know what that flag looks like?
It's still very much with us, that flag.
Yeah.
So that, thanked him for that, but invited him to send an ambassador. And the purpose of the ambassador was to explain to our people, like all ambassadors do, explain the ways of the people. If you can't understand the way they're behaving, go ask the ambassador. Okay. The way that was put, I te reo, was that they would invite him to be a parent to them in their infant state. And that is a complete mistranslation of what was intended. It was, please send us someone who can explain what these people are doing here. Okay, that's 1835. You get further on than that, and still you cannot control those lawless pakehas. And so Te Tiriti was drawn up as an addendum to He Hakaputanga, to the declaration. The primary document is He Hakaputanga. But because these lawless ones would not abide by He Hakaputanga, there was a codicil added that is Te Tiriti. And Te Tiriti agreed to allow British immigration into this country provided the Queen of England kept control of her lawless citizens, of her lawless pākehā. And in the preamble to the treaty, you see this reference to lawlessness that's in there. It was a problem. But even in 1840, there were at most 2,000 of them here and several hundred thousand Māori. So you have Hobson coming over here, and there were a few of them here as well who just wanted to take the country over. They wanted to overrun the country. There was no question about that. But there were very few of them here. And so Hobson did draw up something that said that we would give the whole country to somebody on the other side of the world we'd never met. But the missionaries wouldn't translate that into Māori. And so all of the discussion that went on did not mention that, in fact, Busby had asked that Māori cede their sovereignty to the Queen of England. Now, our people weren't stupid, and so they demanded to know whether this was, in fact, what they wanted, and the missionaries denied that that's what was going on. There were pākehā there at Waitangi saying the missionaries are not being truthful. They were telling Hobson, missionaries are not being truthful. But so that's why you do get some of them just not trusting the missionaries at all and refusing to sign. Others trusting the missionaries and signing them. But if you think about the practical realities of the time, this was a Māori country under total Māori control, very much so under the control of Māori. And everything was being done I te reo Māori. There was no English being spoken amongst the people there. It was all I te reo.
And Margaret, do you have any history in your tribe of someone going, okay, I'd like to, you guys can have my rangatiratanga. Yeah, Tūwharetoa? Here. Do you have any of that? Have you heard of that ever happening?
Yeah.
You have?
Yeah.
What? Here's everything that I, my total control, you can have the whole domain.
Oh, that?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Gee, I was a bit surprised there for a minute.
I thought you were asking if any of us would turn their backs on us. Yeah, they do.
No. I mean, when you talk about the context of the treaty, so you've got two nations, basically, a confederation of chiefs, collectives, and the Crown coming together, Māori outnumber, everything's in te reo. It's inconceivable that Māori would have gone, oh, that lady over in England, yeah, she can have total control. It doesn't make any sense.
Oh, so I think what you call it is humanly impossible.
Human.
And logically absurd.
Yeah, that too. Yeah.
Humanly impossible means if you're a human being and you control your life, that you would suddenly give away all control over everything you do to someone you don't know on the other side of the
world. Yeah, I mean, does that make any sense to you? Doesn't make any sense, does it? So what was the expectation, you believe?
Oh, the expectation was really, really clear.
Mm.
It was that you had these people wanting to come and stay in our country, and our people didn't turn them away because there weren't all that many, really, who were being horrible. There were enough to, you know, to bother.
There were some nice ones too. I was talking to Tamaite Toe down south. He said, oh, yeah, we got on with the whalers and they married him.
We have, and I say things like, you know, the names of Yates and Matthews, they're good Māori names, and people look at me and go, hey.
Yeah, but so there's that kind of relationship building.
Māori names in the far north.
Mm.
So there were those who married into us, you know, and their descendants are still all amongst us today. But you had that minority who were just making everybody's life hell. And that's what forced that sort of... where you had to do something about it. So what was envisaged was, yeah, you can let these people come in, they want to come in, but now they're wanting to stay here. See, before that, effectively before 1840, they were tourists. Mm-hmm. But they wanted to be able to stay here as citizens of this country. And our tūpuna agreed. Yes, you can. You can come in, we give you permission to come in here, but make sure that you abide by the law and that you don't, that the Queen of England protects Māori against
and
any
harm.
And
there would be laws that tikanga would still prevail?
Absolutely. So that's really, really clear in Te Tiriti. It had already been said in He Haka Putangata, but it was just confirmed in Te Tiriti that the law of this country was tikanga. And the Queen could bring her kāwanatanga. Now, that word kāwanatanga has bugged me for a long time because it's a borrowing from English. So for a long time, us academics have said, we don't know what kāwanatanga actually meant to our tūpuna. But having had a good long think about it and having listened, especially during the Paparahi o Te Raki, the Northland claims, I'm pretty sure we do know what was intended, and it was simply that the Queen was devolved the authority to have control over her people, over her British people and others that came in subsequently.
Sort of like devolution.
Yeah, absolutely.
Devolution, we're going the other way.
Yes.
There you go.
So it's only after we won it over it for a while, I come back to kāwanatanga, which we always left in the academic papers as kāwanatanga because we didn't know how to translate it properly. We're now calling it devolved control mechanism.
So if we switch forward, so we get an understanding.
Horrible translation.
Yeah, if we get an understanding of what was envisaged, so a kind of a very visionary, plural kind of a society. Yeah, you know, one that's inclusive, where both peoples can thrive. So that all went belly up pretty quickly. And we get to around now where, I guess, in terms of understanding where we came from and where we are now, we're having this so-called conversation because there's been a call to review the principles of the treaty. And without getting into the weeds too much, the kickback is around how relevant Te Tiriti is now, right? How does it, what is its role and place in 2024? And that seems to create a meltdown or hysteria in some quarters.
Yeah. So I think, and just watching what's been going on, particularly over the last 20 or so years, but perhaps even in a shorter time than that, is that the next, not my generation, I have to say, but the next generation and my mokos are coming through in a way that is much more empowering for our people. So we've managed to push through what my father's generation just could not push through at all, the huge barriers to our people, to finally are being able to get ourselves trained. I mean, I went to a Māori girls' boarding school where we were only ever told that we would be servants in factory.
I went to one too, and I was going to be a nurse, teacher or secretary, which I think are all noble professions, but that was it.
Oh, well, we weren't.
Yeah.
We were going to be housekeepers or factory workers. So, which was really interesting because I got expelled from that school.
You got expelled from Queen Victoria?
No, I got expelled from Rangiatea Māori Girls Hostel. I got expelled from there, but because I had a very good headmistress at the school that I was at, New Plymouth Girls High School, she demanded that I go up to the boarding school at the school itself. That was the Pākehā boarding school. It was an absolute culture shock to be in there, to see how the girls of wealthy New Zealanders are treated. Couldn't believe it. We used to run Rangiatea Māori Girls Hostel. We did everything. We cooked, we cleaned, we did the whole lot. Up at Scotland's, at New Plymouth Girls High School, the only thing the girls ever did was make their beds. The only thing. Couldn't believe it. Massive culture shock for me. But what I have seen happening over the last 10 or so years is, as I say, the young ones coming through confident in both te ao Māori and te ao Pākehā, and being able to succeed and making it really clear to the country that the inequities that are here for Māori are totally unacceptable and that things must change. And that scares, I think. I think it scares people, Moana, because I think they're scared of the unknown. I think they're scared that anything Māori having any say in this country is somehow a threat to them, when in actual fact, Māori have a responsibility for this country that we were given.
So that's something that you told me up at Waitangi. You said you talk about rights. We talk about collective rights, tiriti rights. But rights aren't just, there's more to rights, isn't there? Can you just talk about what's associated with those?
So, you know, we are the mana whenua, we are the people, the first people of this land, and we can't be anywhere but here. This is us. But in that process of being the first people of this land, we also had to learn how the Mother Earth, Papa Tuanuku, operated, how we could live peaceably with her, and how the whole world and everybody who comes to stay here with us can survive and prosper in this country. And when things go wrong in this country, like they have really badly, especially environmentally, and especially around the climate crisis we're in at the moment, it comes back on Māori to fix it up. When you've got whole parts of your society completely marginalised, when you're and totally disadvantaged, totally discriminated against, that is our responsibility. Now let me explain that to you. It's because one of the fundamental values that we have is around manaakitanga, about looking after your manuhiri. We invited people, and our tūpuna invited it. We can never go against what our tūpuna said in that treaty. We invited people in here. We are responsible for them. So when things go wrong for them, it comes back on us. But if you have dispossessed us of everything that we have in order to be able to look after everybody, we can't do our job properly. We have a massive responsibility to look after everybody and this whole country. It's a Māori country. But if you take away our ability to look after you, then things become totally out of balance. And that's the situation you have in this country at the moment, is that things are very, very unbalanced. You've got Papa Tuanaku, our Mother Earth, under huge attack. You've got people, our people, you know, I just see it, even though I just live in Three Kings, and I see, as I go out walking every morning, the number of people living in cars. I see the poverty. I know it when I go home, back to Karikari. My people, we up home, we exercise our own mana. We told government departments to get out 30 years ago. Our people come home to live on our land, but they live in dire poverty. And so my two children who go up there, who are both doctors, they're on call the whole time that they're up there to look after the whānau. During COVID, we had to pull on our own doctors because of the poverty that exists at home. But that doesn't take away the responsibility we have. So, you know, when somebody turns up at the gate and they're desperately in need of help, we can't turn them away. When they get stuck on the beach, when they shouldn't be on the beach anyway, do we leave them there? Well, some of us would like to, but no, we got to tow them out. Because that's our responsibility as mana whenua. We must look after our manuhiri. So what we ask for is to be given back the resources that were taken off us so that we can look after everybody again. Then the place will be balanced. That's what we want.
So if we look back at Te Tiriti, it provided a framework that was inclusive, that would be empowering, reaffirming for everybody. For everybody. Now the conversation's gone a little bit off kilter in Aotearoa at the moment with the suggestion that if Māori are empowered, if Māori are given meaningful influence in different spheres, whether it be health, education, justice, that we're all going to hell in a handbasket, the Māori's going to take over, Pākehā's going to miss out, what about the Chinese? These are the kinds of rebuttals I hear when I'm interviewing different people. So what do people here need to understand? What are the tools that we can use to help people who might be feeling confused or a little bit worried? They might know a little bit about the tree, but they're hearing all the stuff on the radio and on television. How can we support them to understand their place and role?
So when it comes to looking after things Māori, I think we've allowed governments to have, 160, 170 years to see whether they could, whether they knew how to manage this country in a way that Māori were okay in it. And I think they've failed.
I think that, given your academic credentials, you'd be well placed to make that assessment.
Yes, the statistics I look at are pretty horrendous across just about every socioeconomic statistic has us way down. Now,
can I just say, Margaret, that the rebuttal on that would be, well, you know, Māori have got to... So if it's health, you know, everybody's got the same opportunity. We can all go to the hospital. You've got to eat better and look after yourselves better. So how do you, you know, it's where the problem?
Yeah, there's a whole heap of research around this area.
I know. So, but, you know, when you're talking about these kinds of issues, they're the sort of things that land with people.
There are people here who know a hell of a lot more about this than I do, who could tell you. But there was I saw a very good article a few months ago about the realities of when you visit a doctor. And that those, you get what some people would call the worried well. who go to the doctor all of the time because they can go to the doctor all of the time. And then you get people like me, and you'd think that I wouldn't be like this, but I am, where I remember as a child being scared of a doctor, being scared that they were going to tell me off, criticise me, this, that and the other. I don't want to go anywhere near a doctor. I only go to a doctor if I really, really have to, by which time I'm way beyond what I should have been when I should have gone a lot earlier. And I really don't want to bother the doctor because there
That's
must
common.
Be a whole lot of people who are a lot sicker than I am. Why should I go? By the time I get there, I'm way beyond what I should have been. And I don't know how many times I hear about people the first time they are diagnosed as in the A&E. Okay? That is the reality of the health system in this country, although there are others who can tell you far better, including my daughter sitting down here. So,
but there were strategies. There were strategies that were put in place. For example, the Māori Health Authority, which was a co-management, I guess, strategy that had Māori expertise and leadership and input.
Now, if it's a Māori doctor, so what do? No matter what's wrong with me, I ring my children. I don't ring my doctor, because I ring my children because they're doctors. Okay? What do my cousins do? They ring their niece or nephew all the time. They don't ring the doctor, they ring one of their own. And that's the sort of thing that we wanted in the Māori Health Authority, that you could go to the doctor because you knew the doctor. You didn't have to explain. I don't know how many times I would have to sit there and explain the fact that I was Māori to a GP. And I just found that just so horrible to have to justify all the time. But if you go and see a Māori doctor, well, that's all gone. He just wants to know how the whānau is. And have you been home lately? Okay? It's where we feel comfortable. It's where we feel safe. Safe to be who we are. We're not safe in the Pākehā side of the health system. There are really good people in there. They would be horrified to realise that they had offended you. Absolutely horrified. But it's just the way it is. That's why we want to be able to go to one of our own who will say to us, and be quite brutal with us at times, you know, and say, oh, stop being such a wuss. And you don't mind it because it's coming from one of your own who's saying, it's okay, you're all right. Or you need to go to XYZ. So you get, in the medical world, Māori do not get prescribed the medications that they should be prescribed. This, and I'm telling you this stuff out of, this is out of the research, okay? Don't prescribe it because they don't think that the patient will actually go and fill the script. Don't refer them to the specialists that they should be referred to because they're likely not to turn up anyway, so why bother sending them in the first place? It's deeply entrenched racism in the system that doctors, many doctors, are horrified to be told that it is actually institutionalised racism. Okay? That's what we wanted to get out of. Get away from that, have our own in there, our own doctors, our own nurses, making our own rules of the way we are. How can that possibly threaten anyone else other than the fear that maybe money might go there? Well, I can tell you that a whole lot more money gets wasted trying to deal with us in A&E. Okay? Get to us before we get to A&E.
Can I switch subjects and ask, is the treaty honoured once a treaty settlement is secured?
No.
That was pretty precise. What is left to do?
So a treaty settlement, it's not a settlement. So Moana knows that I did a massive amount of research around this after my iwi had been through a so-called settlement process, and I left it. I was one of the negotiators, there were three of us negotiators. We left it for Ngāti Kahu to make the decision as to whether they wanted to settle, and Ngāti Kahu said no. And then we were pretty badly treated as negotiators. So I decided, we kept being told that we were the only ones. Ngāti Kahu was an outlier. So I decided I'd find out if we were. We weren't. We went back and had a look at the development of the policy, and the policy was developed after we had won a case in the Court of Appeal that gave the Waitangi Tribunal the power to order lands to be returned, and the Crown had no right of appeal in there. And that was in 1987, a long time ago. The government that came in after that, that was the Labor government, National government came in absolutely horrified that the Waitangi Tribunal could have any say, or that Māori could have any say whatsoever in any land around the country. But they couldn't repeal the legislation that allowed what we call binding recommendations, recommendations that are binding on the Crown to order the return of land. And they couldn't repeal that because it was actually an out-of-court settlement. And in that out-of-court settlement, the Court of Appeal judges had said, if this doesn't work, come back to us and we'll make orders. So the government has never, ever allowed it to go back to the Court of Appeal. What happened instead was that Doug Graham, absolutely apoplectic about Māori not having a say, and also the tribunal not having a say, constructed a policy whereby all claims, treaty claims against the Crown, would be extinguished, legally extinguished, and that there would be a quid pro quo if Māori could be persuaded to extinguish their claims. And the quid pro quo was to be as small as possible, but it was not to impact on any other New Zealander in terms of monetary or anything else. So there was to be little or no land returned, if possible, and a minimal amount of money, a quid pro quo. But that was what was in the papers that we found. What was sold to the public over it was that it was the Crown accepting it had done all sorts of things wrong, that it wanted to make amends, and that they were being really, really generous, returning 1% or less than what they'd stolen, and really Māori need to be very, very grateful that they're getting anything at all. When people go to negotiate their settlements, they believe the propaganda. So they believe that the Crown wants to be honourable, that it wants to restore its honour, that it wants to make sure that the grievance is taken away. But once you get into negotiations, you find that there is no negotiations, that the Office of Treaty Settlements says to you, this is what your settlement will be. You cannot argue. You have no rights, effectively. You will do what we say, and the job of the negotiators is to go back and tell your people, this is what your settlement will be. Take it or leave it.
I think that was one of the most eye-opening, horrific things that I understood during the making this documentary series, The Negotiators, was how prescribed the negotiation process was and the expectations that people had. You know, the people had of their negotiators, the poor negotiators, you know, the people expecting them to, can I get our land back, we're going to get all this money, we're going to be able to have a say over this and that. And then the negotiators walking in the room being told, yeah, nah, you can't have any land, take that's in private hands, or this land is out of bounds. And then the negotiators having to sort of make these decisions about how they break it to the tribe and what they do. It was just traumatising.
totally traumatising. And when you had people in the iwi who would say, no, this is grossly unfair, Officer Treaty Settlements, in there like a flash to play divide and rule. And divide and rule has always been a very, very good tool of colonisation. And it was horrific in the treaty claims settlement process, where you've got intergenerational trauma that's gone on. It's done huge damage to relationships around there. I mean, I'm talking about brother versus brother, whānau versus whānau. It's just been horrific to hear people. I interviewed people. I interviewed over 150 people who had been negotiators or claimants. Every single one of them traumatised.
I remember one of the negotiators you recommended, Alex Nathan, who was called the last man standing. 27 years of his life at the Waitangi Tribunal, other claimants that died along the way, and then they get to the negotiation thing. He said they'd gone through about three or four different ministers.
That's right.
That's how long the whole thing had gone on. And different teams from the Office of Treaty Settlements that build up relationships. Oh, next minute, that lot's gone. They've got a new one. And part of the... that was really, really difficult. And then part of the settlements are around a Crown apology. And I always remember him saying, we don't want your apology. No. And the Crown saying, well, if you don't take our apology, you're not getting anything. Can you believe it? So they actually worked out that they draft the apology for the Crown. But this is the sort of weird stuff that goes on that, you know, people are subjected to, and I don't know how they stay sane, because it is really, really difficult.
Well, I think for us in Ngāti Kahu, I was just hugely grateful that I had my iwi there, who were really, because it was really clear for the negotiators in Ngāti Kahu, we were not the decision makers, it was the people. And the people just ordered us and said, you will do this. And the thing that we did, which the Office of Treaty Settlements used to hate, was they told us that the negotiations were confidential, so you weren't allowed to have anyone else in the room. Oh, well, Ngāti Kahu didn't listen to that. We just took everybody with us. So they could see what actually happened and what went on. And so at the end of the day, the decision for Ngāti Kahu, it still took Ngāti Kahu nearly 2 years to decide whether they were going to take the this is the last offer. Mm. It still took them 2 years.
And so part of the negotiations process, well, before that, often tribes go to the Waitangi Tribunal. And in some of the interviews that I've done recently, people have said how much information, historical information, is at the tribunal that doesn't get out there. So, you know, the Crown has not done any job of getting that information out there. The media probably too can take a lot of that responsibility. But the Waitangi Tribunal was set up in 1975, and now there's, and I remember it being called a toothless taniwha by somebody once. Who was that?
Don't remember that.
Someone
one.
Onto it. But there is this kind of a fear that the tribunal, there's been talk in the media by some political leaders that suggests that the tribunal is going off its jurisdiction, that it's going beyond its role, that it's radical. So is it?
Not at all. The tribunal itself, for all that it does try very hard to adhere to tikanga, it allows hearings on marae. That was radical, to allow a hearing on a marae, to allow Māori to be spoken in the hearings. That was radical as well.
Because it started off all with lawyers and judges, eh?
Yeah.
When it first started, it was in the ballroom at the Sheraton Hotel or something.
Yeah, up here in Auckland. Mm. Yeah. And because really, if you have a look at the parliamentary debates about the setting up of the Waitangi Tribunal, it was to take the Māori protest off the streets and into courtrooms where it wouldn't be heard, because Māori protest in the 1970s was starting to attract international attention, and that was embarrassing for New Zealand, and so they had to water it down. So they set up the tribunal. The tribunal, even though it hears oral submissions, mind you, I have to say that there was a huge backlash from historians, Pākehā historians, about even listening to oral tradition in the Waitangi Tribunal back in the 1970s. Oh, I had to put up a paper saying why oral traditions held weight. I couldn't believe it. But hey, we do these things. But the tribunal has still erred on the side of the Crown, right the way through. And in that respect, you will find, if you have a look at the tribunal reports, and there are hundreds of tribunal reports, that they do rely heavily on written records rather than oral records. They will hear oral evidence, but then look for the backup in the written record for it. For a very long time, they assumed that Māori had ceded sovereignty. So that was a big barrier for us in the Muri Whenua land claim.
I guess it's a bit of a tricky thing. If you're a creature of the Ministry of Justice,
exactly,
which is part of the Crown, you can't really say, oh, you lot ceded sovereignty, because then you're saying that you actually don't exist.
That's right.
Or am I just being pedantic?
So, but that was the case until 2014.
Yeah.
Until the Paparahi or Te Raki inquiry. See, the difficulty was that the tribunal had never inquired into the documents themselves until the Paparahi or Te Raki, and they found that out. But even though the tribunal has erred on the side of the Crown, the reality was that the evidence that was brought before it was, you know, irrefutable. And even all the evidence that was held, the government evidence in the archives, once you dug through all of that evidence and put it under the spotlight, it failed miserably to say that the Crown had upheld the treaty. It had breached it. And it was the weight of the evidence that is why the Waitangi Tribunal has looked as if it's been very supportive of Māori. But in actual fact, it's erred on the side of the Crown.
And of course it has no, apart from those very odd and rarely used instances, no powers to compel the Crown to do anything.
Well, it's had those, yeah, absolutely. It makes recommendations, and I would say that 80-90% of them are ignored. And reports, Nanaia Mahuta had a report done on how many of the recommendations of the tribunal had been implemented, and you had a hard time finding them in there, any of them that had been. There are some that have been out of the earlier reports. The one around, see, the setting up of the Māori Health Authority came out of a Waitangi tribunal, but it wasn't set up exactly how the tribunal had recommended it. It was still controlled by the Crown.
So now we have a plethora of claims going into the tribunal, given since the coalition government was formed. The tribunal's busy because of smoke-free legislation, Te Aka Whai Ora, Te Reo Māori, constitutional claims.
Yep.
They're flying in thick and fast. So some of the concerns that have been expressed are that the tribunal is moving away from the historical claims and is moving into these contemporary kaupapa things, and this is where there's a bit of tension that's been expressed.
Yes. I don't know why anyone would logically think that because the treaty has been breached up until, I don't know, 1992 or something, when the fisheries Sea Lord's deal was done, that somehow or other it doesn't continue on, when it's abundantly clear, you just look at the statistics, it's abundantly clear that it still carries on. But I think that might be just a bit too confrontational for some politicians to think, well, oh, they're going to make us look even worse again than we already are. The reality is that the tribunal is a commission of inquiry, and it is required to hear all evidence on a matter. It is not restricted to historical ones. And it's an actual fact, the ones that, you know, for this generation that's here now, it's what's happening now that needs fixing up. And the tribunal, as I say, it still errs in favour of the Crown. And so it tries desperately to give the Crown advice that it can follow. But still, they ignore them. Still, they ignore them. And so you keep having the same statistics. They just do not improve. You know, one of the things that the Doug Graham and his crew promised was that things would get better for Māori. Statistics have actually got worse since the settlement process came into being. But the tribunal still remains the only place where Māori can go and be heard and understood. We do have confidence that we will be understood. Whether the tribunal will find in our favour, not necessarily. We know that. But the thing is that we do get to get things on the record, and that's a very important point you make, that the huge amount of knowledge and information that our people part with, and some of it they don't like parting with either, it's knowledge that is very, very precious, and they don't want it abused and misused. But there's a huge amount of knowledge in there, and it's just buried in the tribunal.
So it's interesting when there's a call for a debate that a lot of people don't feel equipped for that. And when we talk about it amongst ourselves, there's a phrase that comes up, constitutional transformation, which makes me want to nod off. It's such a boring academic, excuse me, sorry, phrase. There must be another strap line we can use. But I mean, how do we make it relevant to people? Constitution, then there's you with your families and your kids going to school, there's us doing our jobs and whatever. How do you help people join the dots between the reality of their life and this thing, constitutional transformation, I can't even say it now, re-indigenising our nation or something? How do you make that vaguely relevant and interesting?
Minor Jackson was so clear to us about this that it had to be constitutional transformation because he didn't want it to be just constitutional change where you fiddled with the current system and it had to be start again, constitutional transformation. Now, I never dreamed that that word would still be used, that term would still be used today, and yet it does get used. So when I'm at home, I don't talk about constitutional transformation. I talk about if tomorrow you could make your decisions for your life and you could decide what was going to happen here for you and your whānau, what would it look like? Because that's what it's about. It's about who's going to make the decisions and how are they going to make those decisions. And if it's for your whānau, then for your hapū, then for your iwi, then for the nation. How do we get to make decisions in this country that benefit everybody? How do we get to do what our tūpuna saw as the ideal situation where we all live together in harmony, where you could be proud to be whoever you were, whether you were Ngāti Kahu, whether you were Tūwharetoa, whether you were Scottish, as my mother is, or whoever, you'd be proud to be who you are, and yet you would understand everybody else who was there. That's our responsibility to manaaki everyone so that they can be proud of who they are. And that's what was wanted, was that. So how do we get back to that, is what the constitutional transformation was about. And the constitutional transformation, after we went round, we spent years going round. Moana went to 252 hui. He just said, have kete world travel, and away he went. I went to about 50 of these hui that we held around the country to discuss. And it was known as Mātike Mai Aotearoa. And that was Huirangi Waikerepuru gave us that name. And we went around the country and asked the people, if you could make your own decisions for your own lives tomorrow, what would it look like? And what the people said was actually quite clear. They never talked about the models that we end up talking about, that the tribunal ended up talking about, the rangatira tangosphere and the kawana tangosphere. They talked about the values, about what values should be upheld in this country. And it was all the ones that we talk about all the time on the marae, where we're in gatherings. We talk about our mana, we talk about tapu, we talk about manaakitanga, whanaungatanga. I don't know how many of you know all these words, but there's a lot of... We talk about them all the time. And they kept, and as much as Moana and I would say to them, but how are we going to do it? They'd just say, so long as you get those values right, so long as you include everybody, so long as you make sure that everybody is safe and looked after, the rest of it will flow.
That's interesting, Margaret, because when I spoke with Heather Kame and Max Harris and Kirsty Fong and Manase Lua the other night on my show, and I was saying, how do you reach people that aren't Māori? They said values. You have to use values because so many cultures have the same values. This whole individual thing is not necessarily representative of all cultures.
That's exactly right. Mm-hmm. And there's, when we were doing the work on the Mātike Mai Aotearoa, we're actually better known for Mātike Mai Aotearoa than we are for constitutional transformation, but it's what we were doing. We hadn't been doing it for very long before non-Māori communities started coming to us and asking if they could be part of it. Because the instructions we were given by National Iwi Chairs Forum was, go talk to our own people first. We are responsible for this country. It's us that has to fix up the constitutional mess we've got in this country. How many of you know that this country, the governing system you've got at the moment, doesn't have a written constitution? Oh, you do know. Nice one. You know, I asked my students that, the ones that come over from the United States, whether they could even exist without a constitution, and they go, what? They just can't comprehend that you would have a country without a written constitution. We do have a written constitution. It is he hakaputanga and te tiriti, but the New Zealand government will not recognise it. So we went back to our instructions from National Iwi Chairs Forum was, go back to try and put a constitutional foundation there that rebalances the country. And for that, you need to start, one, with tikanga, the first law of this country, and then he hakaputanga and te tiriti. Build it off that. You can look to the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People as well, because that sets it out in 46 articles, how you're going to do it. But if you set it back on the foundations that our tūpuna put in there, those fellas were just so clever, you know. They knew what they were doing. Set it back on that balance, then you'll be able to proceed from there. And that's exactly what we went out asking the people to do. And this, I have to say, I just got to say this. You know, I actually might, one day, when I deign to speak to David Seymour.
Aren't you related to him?
Oh.
Touchy, touchy.
We can never deny that he's one of ours.
You're all related, all you northerners.
I will actually thank him for what he's done, because what he's done is he's galvanised the Māori world.
I think you stretched it out a bit, actually, just quietly. Beyond the Māori world.
Yeah. Well, I think so too, especially when I've... The number of people who... I saw the ones on your show as well, but the number who have come to me asking how they can help us. And my answer is, can you please be a buffer between us and the government? They are really, really hurting our people, really hurting us. And they're empowering people to attack us in the streets, in the supermarkets, in the schools. We are under attack. We would really appreciate if people would come out and say, stop, stop what you're doing to us. It is hurting people, and hurt people hurt people. And I just don't want to see that.
I think one of the uplifting things that I've seen in the last week are the number of people who aren't Māori, who do understand what Te Tiriti is about, who embrace it, who are not threatened, who understand that it's good for all of us, and are actually actively going out there and sharing it with their community. I mean, I remember in the 80s when we used to go out and do these decolonisation workshops, and, you know, like, I sort of did one, I thought, oh, God, I'm so over this, this is so tiring. And then someone really clever made a decision and said, hey, why don't you Māori just go and talk to your own people?
Absolutely.
And then, and we Pākehā will sort out our lot. But there's wonderful Mitzi Nien and all those crew from way back then who have been Tiriti facilitators, anti-racist facilitators, and, you know, that was an amazing legacy that they left. But there are these new ones that I'm just meeting, and they're like popping out, and they're like going down to Invercargill and places like that. So, you know, hats off to our allies and champions. That's what we need more of, more allies and champions. So I've got this sign. She's like my son when I'm on my show. My son's going, I think I have to stop now for just a little bit, because we're doing an evaluation. Oh, not of us, I hope.
Just some feedback.
Hey?
Just some feedback.
Oh, feedback. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
For us.
Okay, so what do? We do you just carry on, just putting in time. Take the harmony backwards. Don't be the dead stare.
Kia mora, kia mora, ki te mana mo tuha ke me te aroha. Kia mora, ki te mana mo tuha ke me te aroha.
Hey,
ia. E ia, ie, whakaromo, jau toko. E ia, ie. Okie kadokie. Okay, what's the next part of this exciting episode? Oh, there you go.
If you've got any questions,
we'll
collect those as well. And then feel free to go to the bathroom if you need to.
If you've got any questions.
How did
you end up being an academic anyway?
Because I love books.
Oh, she loves books. What's your favourite book of all time?
I don't have a single one of those. Because I like all sorts of different ones.
Mm. Red Peter got you to be impressed. Rob Cooper gave me that bloody hardest book I'd ever read.
I didn't like it.
I didn't. You didn't like it? No. Why? Because it was boring, or because it was too hard, or something?
Not written.
Oh my God. I'm far out. Okay, Paula, for you, go back to the drawing board.
It's a translation from
Portuguese. Oh, yes, yes, a translation. Actually, thank you, Robert. Cut him a break. Is it hard? Oh, now, like, what's in the universities? Academics are getting a bit of a hard time now. Well, I suppose it works both ways, because some academics do say some things they shouldn't.
Yeah, because we're allowed under the legislation to... We have to report on our research, and we are allowed, in accordance with the law, to talk about things that can be controversial.
Can you talk about things that you are not well researched in?
No.
Right, good to know.
No.
Okay, so you've got to stay in your lane?
Yes.
Yes.
Very much so.
And do you have to, if you come out and make a statement about something that's controversial, it might be institutional racism or Palestine?
Yes.
Do you have any particular rules or things that you have to abide by?
It has to be research-based. You have to be able to back up what it is that you say. Kylie, you want to add something else onto that? You know more.
Yes, we've got a really brainy professor sitting here in the second thing. Jeepers, if I'd spotted you earlier, I'd give you the blooming mic, woman.
Yeah, you have to know what you have. It has to be based, it's not opinion. It has to be based on research that you have conducted.
Expert opinion?
Yes.
Expert. Opinion.
Yes.
Okay.
I should be able to be proven.
Hmm. Okay, do we have some questions? Any questions?
We're just collecting them for now.
She's just collecting them? Okay, let me see if I've got anything else here. Is it harder to be a leader in the university than it is harder being a leader at the marae? Which is the trickiest one? I mean, dealing with the deans or dealing with auntie down the road?
Totally different job.
Totally different?
The universities have huge resources.
Yes.
Huge amounts of staff, huge amounts of support. But they're also, I'm only looking at my own university. They've got a strong tradition of racism and internalised racism. Very, very difficult for Māori and Pacific to negotiate. At home, the people love you to bits, but they're as poor hara, they've got no resources, and you're doing everything out of love for everyone. So it's, which one would I rather do? I'd love to be able to take the resources of the university back home.
Maybe you need to take the whānau into the university, that'll be a hoot.
No. They'll tell me off and tell me they want to go home tomorrow.
Can you just while we're waiting for these questions, the third article of Te Tiriti gets waved around as if it's the magic thingamabob for we've all got equal rights. Can you just break that one down for us?
So Article 3 is about the Queen of England promising to protect Māori from any harm, for Pākehā being able to harm us at all, or her subjects being able to harm us in any way, and that we will have full access to British law and culture. So that's essentially all it is. So to say that we've all got equal rights under that, well, no, we've got rights to British culture, and, you know, everything to do with British culture, British, and that includes British law, the rule of law. But we've also got our own tikanga law that's there in Article 2. So we actually have guaranteed access to both. However, having said that, the nature of te ao Māori is because everybody's our manuhiri, they all get access to our way of looking after them and including them as well. But to say that Article 3 gives you equality, not really.
So what would it mean when you're talking about what it really means? How do you translate that into, say, I've got Kylie in my vision here, and you know, say justice. Okay, so Article 3 means that we have access, Māori can have access to these institutions or whatever that the British, the Crown represent, but also we have our own
as well.
So what does that mean in 2024?
Well, it means that you're in New Zealand, and New Zealand is a Māori country, and therefore, if you're going to have a justice system in this country, it has to be able to cater for those who are tauiwi and have their own rule of law. But if you're going to be just, you must also apply tikanga as well. Although I must say, I fear judges trying to interpret tikanga because they haven't been trained in it. And I've seen one or two cases where they thought they could. The training in tikanga is actually a much longer training than it is in law, in what we send people through the law schools for. So, yeah, but the thing is that we did have full access to British law and culture.
So there have been new models that have been brought in, like marae-based...
I have a problem with those.
Okay. I thought those were quite good myself, but anyway. Yeah, okay. Just like the people bringing and running together, you know, that is a model. That is a model that's outside the British justice system.
It is. While I'm not being flippant either about I have problems with it on the marae, because the law on the marae is tikanga.
Yeah.
And when you have to set aside that law, and I saw it actually with the Waitangi Tribunal, where they set aside tikanga for the rule of law, and that's when we start feeling very uncomfortable and unsafe on the one place where we should always feel safe, which is on the marae.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Fair enough. Would it be more accurate to say te tiriti is for the benefit of Pākehā, as it provides a source of legitimacy for their presence in the motu based on tikanga rather than colonisation?
Read that to me again.
Would it be more accurate to say te tiriti is for the benefit of Pākehā, as it provides a source of legitimacy for their presence in the motu?
Yes. Absolutely. I mean, te tiriti was that addendum to he hakaputanga that allowed British immigration into this country. So the very fact that everybody's here is because of the te tiriti. Those who came from outside the country, they're here because of te tiriti. That's why when the people, when they call themselves the tiriti people, what do you call themselves? Tangata tiriti. Tangata tiriti. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Actually, yeah. It's quite interesting because we were having a conversation at work and I was like, what? So there's Pākehā, right?
Yeah.
And then there's people from migrant cultures. So what's the word? What's the phrase? We couldn't come up with, I don't know what tauiwi means, or is it tangata tiriti?
Oh, please, can I explain tauiwi?
Oh, good. Oh, good.
Only because our runanga meeting we had on Saturday, one of our kuia was absolutely adamant that we get it right.
Oh, good.
So, tauiwi. People have tended to say that that means foreigner. But the way our kuia explained it to us was, the word tau, and again, it's like rangatira, splitting the word up. So tau, iwi is tau, and tau is to land or to settle. And iwi is people. So it's the people who landed or settled. Okay? Now, it's really, really simple, and I need to make that really clear, because apparently you've got a Minister of Justice, the man's name is Goldsmith, who takes huge offence to the use of the word tauiwi. And the next time I talk to him, and I have talked to him, I will ask him, since when did he speak the reo, and to be able to tell his workers in the Ministry of Justice that tauiwi is a hugely offensive word. It's not, it's a lovely word.
So is it? Does it cover off, so are we saying it's settlers? Is it kind of like settlers?
Effectively, yeah.
So can it be settlers who came here 20 years ago?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the word that we could use.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's Māori and then there's tauiwi.
Yeah, so the term Pākehā, only because I've heard Pākehā say, some Pākehā say that Hainamana are Pākehā, Chinese are Pākehā, they're not. Pākehā simply means a fair-skinned people. It's all it is. And it's related to what our people used to see, the patu paerehe, the fairy folk. They were always fair-skinned. And so that's fair-skinnedness is the Pākehā. And that's why the word Pākehā does not apply to Asian people, as I have heard sometimes claim.
And so the word Māori, let's just clear that one up.
Just means ordinary, normal. So it was tangata Māori are the ordinary people of here, the normal, usual people of here, as opposed to those who came from elsewhere. And then we were told that now we are Māori. Yeah, well, we are the ordinary people of this country. We are. We're Māori.
Because before, as is now, people were different tribes, right?
So, oh, yes. Yeah,
Ngāti Manua or Tainui or whatever, and then so there needed to be a word that kind of, like how you go,
the ordinary people.
Yeah. So that's a Māori, like why Māori was freshwater, wasn't it?
Yep. Mm. Freshwater, ordinary water, why Māori?
Here's a nice question. How can I hear about future protests or opportunities to show up for Māori?
Listen to Māori radio. Listen, whichever area you happen to be in, you'll usually pick it up there. Or Māori television, or where else, Moana? Because it tends to go along, you know, everybody lets everybody else know.
There'd be different social media kind of platforms where,
yeah,
if there's something happening, it gets out there quick, eh?
Tamaki Treaty Workers Facebook page.
Oh, I like that. I like that. I need to be tagged in, please. Who and what was the biggest inspiration for you growing up?
Ooh. I don't know that there was a single one. Because I've ended up having to fight a whole lot of racism in this country, it does go back to my mother. My mother is Scottish, and she came out here at the end of the Second World War, and until she married my father, she didn't realise how bad the racism was in this country. Absolutely horrified with it, but also horrified at the way my father used to avoid it, just not go anywhere where it was likely to impact him. So she brought us up, me and my brother, with the instruction, if anyone tells you you can't do anything, can't be anything because you're a Māori, do not listen to them. Now, I don't know how many times she told us that, but it's a strong memory I have. I have to say it ended up getting me into a lot of trouble. because it meant that I knew to look out for it and knew to defend myself from it. It still hurt. It hurt terribly. But at least I knew that it was wrong. So that had played a big role. But I think the other thing that played a big role was my aunties and uncles and nannies, my whānau. Because when you're in a hostel, well, not necessarily a hostel, but when you're in a place like a university that's pretty isolating for a Māori, you'd have your own whānau who would always go, wow, because I was the first in my whānau, probably in my hapū, to go to university. That they would always be there and they would always love you, even though you had huge fights. That's okay, but it's your whānau. And they're also, I have to say, your whānau, that the reason they're so important is they're your biggest supporters and your biggest critics as well. And you actually need that.
Do they go, Margaret, Akere, you got that wrong?
Yes.
Oh. And did you say, but yes. Auntie, I just said, no.
No. You just have to listen.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes you want to argue, you won't get far.
Oh, having flashbacks is traumatising. So what about, how do you grow a new generation? Like, so if we look back on the communities that you're involved in back home, but also in the university, how do you mentor younger ones to come through?
Oh, you definitely, it's what my kaumātua did. They pick out the various ones who they can see are good in particular areas, and they just send them to the people who can nurture them in that particular area. And in academia, we do exactly the same. We keep our eye out for the ones who just look as if they've got that little spark in them. And then you nurture them and, you know, you encourage them. And then they run off and work for a government department.
We need our, what do we call them? We need our, not insiders, sleepers. We need our sleepers in there. We do.
Yes.
You have to. I mean, we always have this blooming argument, like this discussion, inside or out. Should we go inside the system or we go outside and, you know, tear it down? Incremental change versus transformational change. How do you get to transformational change if you're not being incremental? How do you get incremental if you don't go inside? Honestly, it keeps me up at night. I know it keeps going up too.
No, we've always had ones who have done that, but what I really appreciate is the ones, and we've got a few of our young ones at the moment who do this, who are quite open. They work for a government department, and they come along and they attend our Runanga meetings, and I go to them, tell me what's happening in the Ministry of Education. Tell me what's happening in the Ministry of Justice. Tell me what we should know. And they're really good. They tell us. Because, hey, we're their aunties, and if they don't tell us...
Hey, it's that accountability thing, eh?
Yeah. So, in actual fact, what I do say to them is, I don't... Even though I just go, oh, there's another one gone. And I just hope that they go down there, learn what there is to learn about, you know, the best way to deal with the enemy is to be there with the enemy and to know him inside out and back to front. But then please come home. That's the thing, is getting them to come home.
Now, I've just noticed that up at the university, there's been a bit of a kerfuffle because somebody's had a little meltdown because there's a space there for Māori and Pacific whānau students. Would you like to comment on that?
It's been there.
And what, did that just happen or has it been there forever?
It's been there since I was a student, and I was a student in 1970, so... We've always had a Māori space, we've always had a Pacific Island space, because the university, the Students' Association, has always recognised that the university is not necessarily a safe place for Māori or for Pacific Island students. They've recognised that, and just give us a space where we can be who we are. So we have that up in Students' Association, we have it in several of the faculties as well, and of course we have the marae, although the marae, of course, is there for us to welcome everyone as well. So that's a wee bit different.
Speaking of education, here's a question. What change are you seeing in the education system to communicate te ao Māori values and knowledge? And what still needs to happen?
Still a great deal that needs to happen, but. Okay, so tomorrow night I do a two-hour class online called the Ngāti Kahu Histories course. And the Ngāti Kahu Histories course is a postgraduate course for all the teachers who teach in Ngāti Kahu's territory, so that they will learn the history traditions of Ngāti Kahu. History traditions, but what happened was that when we went through that trauma of the treaty claim settlement process, the Office of Treaty Settlements demanded that they write our, what do they call it?
Historical account?
Oh no, the whole lot, you know, the settlement settlement deed.
Mm.
And Ngāti Kahu said, no, we've got people who can do this, and told us to write it up. Government wouldn't look at it, so we published it as a book. And it is the history, the traditions, the values. It's 385 pages of Ngāti Kahu. And then when teachers were told they had to teach according to the local stuff, I just said to them, go read the Ngāti Kahu book. And then our kuia, who are lovely, they go out and see the schools all the time. The school said, we don't know how to teach from that book. And me being me said, that's all right, I'll run a course on it for you. This year we had 93 people in that course.
That's lovely.
And 143 observers.
That's weird.
I really fear that this government will cancel. So it's the Ministry of Education that pays for that. I refuse to teach a course, a postgraduate course, for teachers without the Ministry of Education paying for it. The Ministry of Education paid for it. I fear that they may withdraw that funding.
Because there are some amazing educators out there that are very concerned. They've done a lot of work in shaping a curriculum too in the schools. I've got siblings in education, and I've heard a lot from teachers. What needs to happen? What do you think needs to happen so that education is part of the answer to reducing the ignorance that we see prevail?
What I see that is really successful in education, even though it's hugely underfunded, are our kohanga reo, our kura kaupapa, our whare kura, and our wānanga. But the Māori students that I get out of the whare kura are far better prepared for the world generally. The success rates, I don't know how many of you know that the success rates in NCEA is much higher in the kura, in the Māori area, in the kura than it is in mainstream schools, in Pākehā schools. That is a model for the whole country, because the tamariki in there have to come out of there able to survive i te ao Māori and i te ao Pākehā. Every single person in this country has a right to that. It's one of the things I get really angry about. I consider it's a human right of every citizen of this country to be absolutely fluent in te reo Māori, and that you have been deprived. If you are not, you have been deprived of a right that you have. You also have a right to understand completely tikanga, the way we are in this world, and that you have been deprived of a human right in that. So that's where you look to the kura kaupapa, Māori, the kohanga reo on that, for a model of how to do it properly. I keep asking the teachers, please go and talk to the teachers at Rangiāni Wenua. And then I go, oh no, you're hugely under-resourced, you're already under the gun, I shouldn't be sending others
over. That's
there,
the challenging thing, eh?
Yeah.
It's like, be careful what you wish for, because, you know, then our people get under strain. Now, there's a lot going on, and it's going at pace.
Yeah.
It's easy to get distracted. How do we avoid being reactionary and keep the eye, our eye on the end game? If we, if say the end game is constitutional transformation, you know, there's a lot of stuff that's floating around out there, and you go, oh, look at them, they're having a fit about the bloomin' Māori space up at university, and you can eat, then they're painting over the bloody pedestrian crossing down there. I mean, oh my God. And then you can spend your time having a meltdown, because those are important. But it might be a little wee trick too.
You see, this is why I'm asking that our, and I call them our tauiwi allies, all of you people who want to be there. If you could be that buffer so that we can get on and do the constitutional transformation part that we need to do. And that is, for the Māori side of it, we want to take back control of our own lives. We want to take back control of who we are, of who makes the decisions for us, which is ourselves. And for that, we want to set up what we call the rangatiratanga sphere, where Māori make decisions for Māori. Now, in order to do that, we have to all come together, and that's what I'll eventually thank David Seymour for, because it has brought our people together at Tūranga Waiwai, at Ratana, at Waitangi. There's another one coming up on the 31st of May in outside Hastings, at Omahu Marae, outside Hastings. Bring Māori together so that we can then decide what making our own decisions about our own lives actually looks like in practice. We want to be able to do that. We want the space to be able to do that. We need to pull our people together to be able to do that. And we need our tauiwi allies to make the space for us to get the government off our backs so that we can just get on and do it.
So, how many people here have read Matiki Mai? Oh, I like this place. Wow. So there's something that people could look at if they haven't. Now, the government holds legislative power, but political leaders are having a strong cultural influence, I guess, in shaping these so-called debates. So what strategies and tactics can be employed to mitigate that?
Well, see, one of the things which is why I agree to come and talk to people, although I've still got marking to do at home, is because people have to be given the information. And you have to be informed about what things are and be able to understand what is misinformation, what is disinformation, and what are the facts out there. There is a huge amount of confusion out there, and I understand that. Hey, and it's my role as an academic to try and help in that area. But in terms of some of the stuff that's coming out, for example, David Seymour and his State of the Nation speech. It was a gift to a linguist. That speech was an absolute gift because it was a masterclass in white supremacy and racism against Māori. And when I said that to several ministers, they just went, ooh, you know, you're not allowed to say things like that to ministers. And I said, well, then I'll explain it to you. So being the linguist I am, I went through it sentence by sentence and said, this is white supremacy, this is racism against Māori. And that's what we need to be able to do, is to have sufficient number of facts and understandings behind us so that when these things come up, we're able to say, yes, that's correct, or no, that's wrong, and this is the reason why. And that's what I'm asking for our people, is that they fully understand he hakaputanga, te tiriti, who they are and the responsibility we have for this country, so that when they do get attacked, as they are getting attacked, they don't have to carry that pain that we've had to have, that I had as a child for so long. The attacks still come, but they're not as painful. I don't know, as we get older, Moana, whether it's not as painful.
You're looking at me, stop it. No, but I think also it is about growing allies, growing supporters. That,
it is.
You know, it's been great seeing the different voices that have been popping up and going, hey, hang on. Just, you know, wind it back. No, we do not support this.
Yeah.
I think new voices, diverse voices, loud voices across all different platforms is a great mobilising tactic that needs to be employed.
Yep, absolutely. So, you know, I'm just hugely thankful to those who have come and asked, how can they help? Because we really do need help, really do. So that we can get on and be who we are. And so that my mokopuna will go, I know who I am, and nobody's going to tell me that I'm not this or that, and that this territory is my territory, and it doesn't belong to that fella down the road who thinks he owns it. So, kia ora.
Kia ora. Do we have any last couple of questions? We've got like 5 minutes. Yes. Hang on, just need to up your... Oh. It's all right, in front of the speaker.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you so much to ladies for your speech. I'm moving to New Zealand and Auckland in January, and then years ago, and then I sort of started busy with settling and moving to houses. Then I remember in beginning of February, I sent kids to the school, but after a couple of days, and it was a holiday, and then I asked the teacher, what holiday is that? And first time I heard Waitangi. And also first time the teacher told me, oh, this is a Maori word. So then I just learned that. It's sort of like has that little picture of Maori people just by looking at the word Waitangi. And I have to say, thanks to the COVID, then I found myself can be quiet down to sort of learn a bit more knowledge about this Waitangi, probably just last 5 or 6 years. It's just out of my instinctive feeling of a human being. I have to say, according to all these historical facts, why do we need to make this Waitangi Days like kind of a festival or celebration? Is that, I mean, for all, no offense, maybe for some people, but for really for here, in how to say the word, indigenous people, isn't that quite sad part of history? Okay, that's one question. Another question.
Okay.
As far as I know, there is a Maori king or queen. Oh, if we have another king or queen birthday as a holiday, why can't? Is it fair we should have Maori king or queen's birthday?
Okay, thank you very much for your interesting questions. Thank you. There'll be an opportunity for you to speak to Fire Margaret after this, and Kylie. Yeah, Kylie's hanging out for that. Thank you. Welcome. No mai hara mai. Okay, well, you might be Margaret. Catch a pie, Queen.
Okay, so I think that this is a bit of a wrap for us. Really appreciate everyone coming out here on just before Easter. And thank you to our hosts for having us here tonight. Thank you for inviting me. I hope that there was something productive that you got out of this conversation. And if you like, you can always Google Margaret Mutu and find her fantastic essays and expert opinion online. There's lots of opportunity. But yeah, I think a key message for us is that we're all in this together. I think the movement is getting bigger and bigger. She told me when I was at Waitangi, I said, oh my God, how are you feeling? This is so depressed. She goes, I'm feeling positive. I'm feeling hopeful. I'm like, are you serious, woman? She was. And then I asked, Honi Harawira. He goes, I'm feeling positive. I'm like, oh my God. Maui saw my friend. I'm thinking, are they all loony? What's going on here? No, they're all feeling like, and maybe it's a little bit of shock doctrine. I don't know. What do you think, Margaret? Have the last say.
No, I think that I keep saying, one day I'll thank David Seymour. I have never seen National Iwi Chairs Forum so united. We're usually niggling at each other, not this last meeting. And then when we went to Tūranga Waiwai, how many of you went to Tūranga Waiwai who were here? A few of you did. The feeling of unity down there was just so beautiful. And the same at Waitangi. It was beautiful up there. Even though there was anger, it was very carefully displayed in complete accordance with tikanga. And it made sure that everybody felt that they belonged at Waitangi. Waitangi is very, very important to us. And we do commemorate rather than celebrate. I'd hope to live to the day where I can see it being celebrated. Maybe not, but my moko will. My moko will. Because we're going to do this by 2040. That was Moana's instruction to us. Get this done by 2040. So, haramai 2040. Kia ora tātou.
Kia ora. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for having us.